Hello everyone, it's Chuck Cornavale, co-founder of FastGraphs, the Fundamentals Analyzer software tool, and one of the founding partners of the Dividend Kings marketplace service on Seeking Alpha. You know, we've obviously had a very, very trying times here recently. The stock market is extremely volatile. We've had massive down days, massive up days, and here we are on Monday, March 16th, 2020, seeing another significant down day. So what I thought I'd like to do here is try to give you all a little bit of a perspective of what the market actually looks like. And one of the best ways for me to do that is to turn to the Dow Jones Industrial Average, an index of 30 stocks that basically are used as a proxy for the overall market or the general health of the overall market. So I'm going to go through these very, very quickly. I'm going to look at them from a valuation perspective, strictly on adjusted operating results or earnings, which are the ones that are most talked about when you're looking at financial sites like the Wall Street Journal or Seeking Alpha or any of the other major financial sites. And what I want you to get from this is I want you to see what the market actually looks like from a standpoint of the individual companies and the valuations of the quote-unquote Dow Jones. I want to just give you a brief overview for those who aren't familiar with this video. The orange line on this graph would represent the theoretical fair value of the stock based on widely accepted formulas for valuing a business. The black line is monthly closing stock prices. The green shaded area are the dividends once they've been paid out. The white line are dividends while they're still part of the company, and below the white line shows the payout ratio. But again, since I've got 30 stocks to cover, I'm going to go very, very quickly, and I'm going to look at both a long-term scenario and then a shorter term. And in the first example, I'm going to start with the shorter term. This is Apple, one of the most popular and largest and, you know, highest quality technology stocks, obviously, on the planet. And what I want you to see here is that the company has grown earnings at about 14.25% since the beginning of fiscal year 2012. And by the way, their fiscal year ends in September. So here we're looking at Apple. My argument is that Apple came into this market malaise significantly overvalued relative to its historic norms. You can see how the price tracked earnings over that time frame. Now, the reason I started with the short-term view in this one, because I want you to see both, is because when you look at the long-term, notice the growth rate of 14.25% right here. When I switch to the longer-term view of Apple, you'll see that historical growth has been over 25%. But what I'm really suggesting here is I shorten time frames on Apple. You'll see that the earnings growth rate slows down dramatically because the fast growth for Apple is behind it. So more recently, it was 18% growth. And then as I went into the one that I showed you initially, we're down to 14% growth. And just very quickly, forecasts are expected to be about 9% growth over the next couple of years, which again is another slowdown. So that would tell me that the stock price is vulnerable and has been vulnerable. But I do want to make a point before I go to my next selection, and that is that this kind of faded out section with the dashes is forecast. Everything that's dark here going backwards are actual results. You'll notice I put an E on the numbers here, which stands for estimates. The biggest problem I have, and I want you all to be aware of it before I go on with this video, is that we really don't know what these forecasts are going to look like, because in light of this coronavirus, we've obviously had some significant economic impacts. Some industries are obviously going to be dramatically affected more than others. But the point is that I do believe there's going to be an economic impact. I think this virus and the issue is going to last several months. That puts us into the potential to see some weak quarters. I think long term, everything, you know, will return back to normal eventually, and the earnings power of most of these companies will also return to normal. But I do want you to be aware of the fact that all bets are off as to whether or not these estimates are going to come to fruition. So I really want you to focus your attention on what actually already has happened with these companies, because we have too much uncertainty in the future. So I'm going to move on to my next example here. I'm going to look at American Express. We all know them from their credit card. And if I look at it again from this short-term view, I want you to notice earnings growth has averaged about 9.5%. The company has a very low dividend payout ratio. You know, the last dividend payout ratio was about 20% of earnings. You can see that the price has fallen in this case, but it hasn't been as dramatic as you're going to see with some others. So anyway, just utilizing this view of American Express, I would argue that American Express has become very, very attractively valued. The blended P.E. ratio is about 12. That's not unprecedented in its history. I do believe this company is going to do fine longer term. And this would be, to me, I'm looking at what I would consider to be an opportunity here. Now, moving on, I'm going to go into Boeing. Now, I want to make a point with Boeing that I think is very, very important. Boeing has already had an event risk of its own with their 737s, you know, falling out of the sky and then continuing issues there. So I do want you to know that notice that the stock price tracked earnings, I've got a 15 PE ratio in this orange line here. The blue line in this example is a PE of 19. And you could see that Boeing stock price traded sort of within that range. And when it got outside that range, you know, it always moved back into that range. And now all of a sudden we saw earnings collapse from $16 a share in 2018 to negative $3.47 last year. And then this year we're expected only to recover to about $4. That's still significantly below the 16. That's this number right here. And then eventually the market does believe that Boeing's going to get back into these higher earnings per share numbers. And if that's true, then, you know, looking out in the future, Boeing could be attractive here, but there is obviously a lot of risk. But I do want you to notice that this stock has had a much more severe reaction than what I've shown you so far, but that's also not just alluded to the virus and the current market volatility we're facing, but because this company had its own set of troubles, if you will. My next example, I'm going to take a look at the cyclical Caterpillar, you know, maker of, you know, tractors and earth moving equipment, etc. And you can see this stock is cyclical. It has a very good dividend record. You can see that the price tracks operating earnings very consistently over time. We are expected a down year this fiscal year, which ends in December. The stock price has reacted and fallen dramatically, but I do believe it's fallen below what fundamentals would support. I don't think fundamentals are going to crater on this stock all that bad. We might have a bad quarter or two, but I think longer term it's going to be attractive. Anyway, this one, because of the uncertainty of cyclical stocks anyway, has had a pretty severe correction in its price. Now, next here, we're going to take a look at Cisco, the technology giant. And what you're going to see here is, again, an interesting story that, you know, you can see that the company's stock price has gone through periods of being excessively overvalued and then through periods of being excessively undervalued. It was recently overvalued in 2019 by July. It's now become very, very attractive with a yield approaching 4%, might actually have hit that today, and a blended PE ratio under 12. So Cisco looks very, very attractive here. And from a standpoint of a price drop from fair value, it's held up better than a lot of companies have. The next stock in the Dow 30 that I'm going to look at is Chevron, one of the big oils. We'll also look at Exxon a little later. These are the ones that are really troublesome. I'm really not sure what the estimates are going to look like for these companies for the next couple of quarters. You know, we obviously got the Russian-Arab oil war going on, if you will, right now, where they're talking about flooding the market with oil and the price of oil is collapsing. So it's really hard to create a forecast. And these stocks, you know, Chevron has fallen rather precipitously here in this market, but it's not anywhere near as bad as it looks. And based on current earnings forecasts, it would actually only be fairly valued and not undervalued. But again, we don't know what those earnings are going to look like. The next would be Disney. And you've probably already heard that Disney has closed most of its parks because of the coronavirus. And, you know, that's obviously going to have an impact on their finances. I would also add that Disney has a cruise line as part of their entertainment package, but the most important aspect of looking at this particular graph as one of the Dow 30 is that earnings were weak last year and were expected to be weak again this year, and that's prior to what we've actually seen occurring here in the last couple of weeks or so. The stock was very vulnerable. It was significantly overvalued, in my opinion, relative to its fundamentals, and we've had a pretty strong correction, but I don't know that the correction is over in Disney. I would still consider this, even in light of all the volatility we've had, an overvalued Dow stock. The next is Dow itself, which was broken up and spun off, so I've got a very short history here. But the point is, the stock has gotten very inexpensive, offers a dividend yield of almost 11%. I haven't done a lot of work on this one, but it certainly looks very, very attractive from a pure valuation. But again, the key is, what are these earnings forecasts going to look like? And that's a big unknown and certainly a big uncertainty. The next stock I want to look at in the Dow is Goldman Sachs, one of the more famous investment bankers and brokers out there in the world. I do want you to notice the volatility of this particular company. I do want you to notice that their stock price has tracked that volatility, but I also want you to notice that the market has been providing what I would call a discounted value to most stocks in the financial services sector anyway for the last several years. In light of the great bull market that we've been experiencing, these stocks have not really been valued. They've been valued around 10, 11, 12 times earnings. You see the blue line on this graph is 12 as it's drawn. It's a reference. So you can see there's been times when Goldman was trading at 10 times earnings. The stock has become very inexpensive, however. A PE of 8, that's what I would call half of what theoretical intrinsic value, and about a third below what it would be. The question is, what are these earnings forecasts going to look at? But here's where we stand. This stock has actually not suffered a great deal because it was already undervalued coming into this market. I think that's the point. The next Dow stock I'm going to show you is Home Depot. And if you look at Home Depot, it's had a surge of growth coming out of the Great Recession. If I lengthen this graph going all the way, it was averaging about 12 or 13% growth. You can see that growth does tend to slow a little bit during recessions. It slowed from real strong growth in the 2001 recession, still had double digits through the Great Recession. We had two or three bad years where it got down to about a 14 or 15 multiple. You can see, PEs 13, 15, etc. But then we've had this surge in growth, and as a result, we've had a surge in how the market has been valuing the stock. They've been putting a 20 PE. It has not fallen very much in this market. I think that's important. We've got no bargain being created in Home Depot relative to what I'll call historical norms. So this is one that I believe still remains fully valued to not overvalued. IBM is a tech giant that most of us would probably recognize as being in transition. They've had several years of weak earnings. However, they are moving from essentially a giant mainframe computer company to a cloud company like most tech stocks are. Their earnings are expected to grow going forward. I'm not sure how much impact of the coronavirus is going to have on them, but this, the stock price has fallen. You can see the fall here has not been overly onerous compared to some of the stocks we've already looked at, but it has a very low PE, a very nice dividend yield currently of 6% if you picked up shares today, and an earnings yield of almost 12%. So IBM looks very, very attractive. My next is also in the technology sector, another technology giant, Intel. If I look at it from a standpoint of short-term performance, I want you to notice that Intel was already reasonably cheap before all this volatility struck. The stock has fallen a little bit, but not very much relative to the most ones I've showed you, but it is inexpensive with a blended PE of 11, dividend yield of 2.5, and a pretty good dividend growth record over the last several years. Now, this is one of my favorite to look at here. This next stock is Johnson & Johnson. When you look at it, Johnson & Johnson's stock price kind of tracks earnings very, very nicely. It was, maybe fully valued. I wouldn't really call this overvalued here. It's fallen, very little in considering all the market volatility we've had. Now, there have been times when the market has really priced this at a high value and caused it to be a very poor long-term investment. But the company itself has been a very consistent performer, and it's really held up quite well in this market melee that we're currently going through. The next would be the other major bank, JP Morgan Chase & Company. And again, if you look at the long-term graph here, you can see that there's some cyclicality in earnings. JP Morgan held up better than most of the major banks did during the financially driven Great Recession of 2008 and 9. It's been performing very nicely since then. If I shorten the graph again to a more modern time frame, it's another example of trading around 10 to 12 times earnings. The blue line here is 11.79 or 11.8 times earnings, if you will. The stock has fallen, but it's become cheap, offering a 3.5% yield, a blended PE under 10. So there is a nice bargain, I believe, in JP Morgan manifesting right now. It's an A-minus rated company with relatively low debt. The next example I'm going to take a look at is Coca-Cola. Coke has been a company that the market has always provided, at least to the time I followed it, has had a tendency, I should say, or a penchant for putting a very premium valuation on this stock, I think more than their fundamentals deserve. But nevertheless, it was overvalued even on that basis coming into the beginning of 2020, and it has now corrected back to what would be a normal valuation for the recent market. However, I do believe this stock is still very, very expensive. It is a high quality company. It has, 45% debt. It's A+ rated. is giving us a good dividend yield, but this is one that I still think is fully valued, if not overvalued, even in spite of this market correction we've had. The next example is McDonald's. Now, McDonald's is a restaurant chain. This is an industry that I think is actually very, very vulnerable to the crisis. We've had other restaurant chains falling dramatically. The company is taking action to stop the spread of the coronavirus by limiting or encouraging at least customers to do takeout and not get exposed to other people. The stock was really overvalued, in my opinion, coming into this market. I think this correction has started, but I'm not sure that this stock is still cheap enough to attract me. It does have a dividend yield of about 2.8%, earnings yield of 4.5%, and again, I consider 6.5 to 7 a minimum earnings yield that I would consider fairly valued. So I would consider McDonald's still overvalued in spite of what we've seen in this correction here. The next example is the widely recognized and well-known industrial conglomerate 3M. 3M was massively overvalued in 2018. The stock has corrected significantly. I believe that they did have some financial issues here. 2019, they had a negative 11% earnings growth, but that's not the first time this has occurred. But the stock has fallen over 40%. That's worse than the overall market and the overall reaction to the coronavirus. It has fallen pretty dramatically from a more realistic valuation, at least during the virus spread. You can buy it at still at a PE of over 15 relative to a lot of the other stocks we've looked at. It's still relatively expensive. Great company, starting to get attractive now. Depending on how this all shakes out, you might want to take a long-term look at 3M as a quality company that the market likes to value at a high premium. So this is one of the better buys on 3M that I've looked at, but I still wouldn't consider it dirt cheap. The next one would be the pharmaceutical major and giant Merck. And you can see that Merck was moderately overvalued. It's now trading at roughly fair value, a blended PE of just 14.5. Does have a 7% or 6.9% earnings yield now and a dividend yield above 3%. This might be a very attractive company to look at going forward if you're looking for, you know, quality. It's AA rated, has 44% debt. The next example, of course, is the mighty Microsoft. And I really find this one interesting because Microsoft was hated not too many years ago. This is kind of when people talked about Steve Ballmer running the company. And then we had this surge in growth as the company really has adapted to what I call the new internet realities of the cloud, et cetera. So it's done extremely well. Earnings growth has held up at around the 10% rate for the last 5 or 6 years. If I shorten this time frame, you'll notice that it's accelerated to 10 or 12%, but I do believe this is a very overvalued stock. And the market correction that we've gone through, it's still held up. It hasn't corrected very much. This is a tough one. If you own it, I'm not sure it's a sell, but on the other hand, I don't think it's very attractive as a long-term buy, especially in light of all the other names that we've looked at. Another example of a stock that's been very popular in recent years has been Nike. You can see that the stock got significantly overvalued. This has been a greater reaction to the virus and so on that we've seen with a lot of the Dow stocks so far. I do still consider this stock very expensive. The PE is over 26, and I don't see it offering anything that would justify that kind of valuation, but other than the fact that people still continue to like the company. But you can see the correction here, it's fallen from 101 down into the 70s, and it's down again today, the last time I looked. The next company I want to look at real quickly is Pfizer. Pfizer is another major pharmaceutical, a little bit different than Merck in that they did have some negative earnings growth, and the stock price, I think, was reacting more to that than it was the coronavirus. It actually held up pretty well in light of the virus itself, but it's become very inexpensive with a very nice dividend yield approaching 4.75%. Procter & Gamble is significantly overvalued, in my opinion. It has been. The correction here has been relatively minor. It is a very high-quality company with little debt, so that might be helping support the stock, but I don't see any bargain in Procter & Gamble at this point. Travelers is a multi-line insurance in the financial sector. It's got relatively cyclical earnings. You can see it's trading at one of the lower valuations it has historically. it can be very, very attractive here with a dividend yield in excess of 3%. If you like multi-line insurance, Travelers might be one to look at. United Healthcare has been a Dow stock that's held up extremely well through this whole market malaise. It even held up pretty well during the Great Recession. It got into some low valuations here, but you can see the recovery was steady and consistent. It's currently trading at a blended PE of about 17, but it's also growing faster than most of the Dow stocks. You know, the earnings growth rate here is 19%. Forecast growth is still expected to be double digits, over 13%. Again, all bets are off on forecast now, but United Healthcare is certainly a high quality company, A plus rated with 37% debt, but it hasn't really participated in this market meltdown. I think that's one of the things to see there. I'm going to move on to United Technologies, an industrial conglomerate. You can see how its price has tracked earnings. It's had little bouts of cyclicality. The stock was very vulnerable to some bad news. It fell precipitously. I would consider this one extremely attractive for a high-quality industrial conglomerate like United Technologies. So we have had a major correction in UTX. Visa is another very popular common stock out there. It's had tremendous growth, averaging over 20% growth. The market has been valuing it very high. We have had a correction in Visa here with the virus, but it's been nowhere near as severe as we saw with a lot of the other companies. It still trades at a very high multiple, trading over 30 times earnings, has dividend yield under 1%. It is AA minus with 25% debt, but I don't think there's any bargain in buying Visa today. At one time, it was a great bargain. The next example I want to look at is Verizon. Verizon has held up extremely well here. I want you to notice it's fallen with the virus scare, but it's really just almost normal volatility here. But you can buy it at 11 PE with a 4.5% dividend yield, and it's probably very attractive and well positioned for the future. Walgreens Boots Alliance, which has gone through a lot of turmoil here, it was very overvalued a couple of years ago. It's become extremely cheap, 7.8. Blended PE, a dividend yield that I think is probably exceeding 4% today if I got a quote on it. But you can see this stock has gotten very inexpensive with what's going on in the marketplace. My next example is Walmart. Walmart, I believe, is simply an overvalued stock. I can get the idea that people think in crisis, people shop at a discount retailer like Walmart, the biggest discount retailer, I might add. But I don't consider this stock cheap at all. I don't consider it a good long-term investment here. I would have considered it a good long-term investment when it was trading at better valuations. And last but not least, I want to take a look at the oil giant Exxon. A couple of things about this. I do want you to notice that their payout ratio has exceeded 100%. The company is obviously facing a great deal of stress, just like we saw with Chevron. The price has fallen precipitously. This is, you know, not just the coronavirus, but also the pending issues with OPEC, Russian oil war that's going on. But the company is a AA-plus rated. It was, you know, one of the AAA rated stocks, has very low debt, and it certainly has the financial resources to weather this storm. And the stock is getting relatively cheap. The real question is, what are the fundamentals going to look like? And is energy going to recover enough to keep Exxon a top drawer dividend producer in the long run? Anyway, this has been a look at the 30 Dow Jones industrial stocks. I hope you found this interesting. I think there's some real good perspective to be gleaned by looking at, not just trying to look at the overall market and the overall Dow, because there's been a lot of talk about how much the Dow's moved in a given day. This way you get to see the individual pieces, and I hope it's given you a better perspective of what the market as measured by the Dow Jones actually looks like. This has been Chuck Carnival saying thanks for watching. If you like this video, please don't forget to subscribe to our channel here. We'll be doing a lot more in the future. We'd love to see you back. Thanks again.